Bedell. I trust you are well this morning. It's Tuesday and we're in the second day of Holy Week. And let's just open up in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just pray that as we go through this Holy Week, Lord, we focus our attention on you. We focus our attention on the journey that your Son Christ had to endure. And so, Lord, this morning as we just share a devotion and we spend some time in prayer, Lord, we just pray that once again it will bring our focus towards the cross. And we pray all of this now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So, just imagine. It's Tuesday morning, March 31st, 33 AD. The disciples are there and they're pointing to a withered fig tree that Jesus had cursed the day before. Jesus gives his disciples a simple lesson from it. Have faith in God. In particular, he's saying that if they have undoubting faith, they can throw even mountains into the sea. Now, if the disciples had ears to hear, they would have recognized that Jesus was talking more than seemingly magical powers that could curse trees and crumble mountains. He is talking about bigger realities than this. Note that he closes this mini lesson on mountain-moving, undoubting faith by saying, and this comes from Mark 11, verse 29. And whether you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may also forgive your trespasses. Jesus is reminding them that failing to forgive looms as a bigger obstacle to answered prayer than a mountain. And let me repeat that. If you are failing to forgive, it's far bigger than the obstacle you're facing. The disciples will soon face great challenges to their faith and their ability to forgive. Will they remember this withered tree on the road from Bethany? As soon as they approach the holy city, the events from the day before could not have been far from their minds. As Jesus enters the temple mountain, crowds gather to hear him teach. In Luke 21, verse 38, and the chief priests, scribes, and elders waste no time in making their move. They will try to lay four traps to ensnare their adversary. The first trap is whose authority? By whose authority they demand to know had Jesus carried out his actions the day before? And that's from Mark 11, verse 28. Jesus doesn't take the bait. Instead, he turns the tables on them with a question of his own. Was the baptism of John from heaven or from man? And that's from Mark 11, verse 30. If they respond from heaven, the next question is obvious. Then why don't you believe the one about whom John testifies? If they retort from man, they risk alienating the crowd that hold John in high esteem as a prophet. Jesus then offers three parabolic stories about two sons, murderous tenants, and guests at a wedding feast, all driving home that point that they are rejecting grace and truth in the service of hypocritical self-righteousness. The second trap, whose allegiance? The leaders try a new tactic. They send the Pharisees, a Jewish sect known for their zeal for the law, and the Herodians, those loyal to Herod's dynasty, to ask him a question. If it is lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? If he answers yes, he shatters the people's expectations of him as a Messiah who will overthrow the Roman rule. If he says no, he can be arrested for fomenting a revolt. But Jesus evades the either-or dilemma. The denarius has Caesar's image on it. As long as Caesar's in power, it is appropriate to pay taxes to him. And we also give to God the things that are God's. Since we are all made in God's image, we owe everything, all that we have, and all that we are to him. Pay your taxes and worship God. The third trap, whose wife in the resurrection? After Jesus had silenced the Pharisees and the Herodians, the Sadducees, a Jewish sect denying the end-time resurrection of the dead, tried to ridicule Jesus' belief in the of the resurrection by asking him a trick question about marriage in heaven. Jesus tells him that they do not understand the scriptures or the power of God. Like the others, they smirk, and their smirk suddenly turns to marvel as they grow silent. The fourth trap, which commandment? Now the Pharisees sent forth an expert in the law to question Jesus. Which of the commandments is the greatest? They ask him. Jesus summarizes his answer in one word: love, to God and for your neighbor. Now it's Jesus' turn to initiate some questions with those who are trying to trap him. When he asks them a question about Psalm 110 and how the Messiah can be David's Lord, no one was able to answer him with a word, nor from that day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. In Matthew 22, verse 46, Jesus then launches a lengthy, scathing critique of the scribes and the Pharisees, pronouncing seven woes of judgment upon these hypocrites and blind guides. This full-scale verbal assault removes all doubt concerning Jesus' intention, agenda, and his aims. He has no desire to ally himself with the current leadership. He has come to overthrow the authority. There's no way both sides can survive the escalating conflict. Either Jesus will assume power or he must die. Grace and truth in every trap. With another tension-filled day behind them, Jesus and the disciples begin to head back to Bethany. They stop on the Mount of Olives to rest, giving them a wonderful view over Jerusalem as the sun begins to set in the west. The disciples marvel at the size and the grandeur of the impressive buildings, but Jesus tells them that a day is soon coming when not a single stone will be left upon another. He goes on to explain that his followers will experience increasing persecution and tribulation leading up to that final day of judgment, but their task is to remain vigilant and persist in faith. People, Tuesday is now done. But Friday is coming. This is not the Jesus some of us learned as children. This is the real historical Jesus, fully in control as he responds with grace and truth to the traps on all sides. He knows what he's doing. He knows what is coming. Every word, every step is for the fame of his Father, for his Father's name, and the salvation of those willing to pick up their cross and to die with him. Let us pray. Father, we just thank you. We thank you that your Son, through all the trials and tribulation, remained righteous. He defended and was able to answer any questions or traps that were put to him. Lord, we just pray that as we continue this journey, as we continue to dwell on these words, that you'll minister to us and it'll be a life lesson. And so, Lord, we thank you this morning. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.